Yes, exactly. I just wanted to mention that. Very beautiful. Right. This is clear.
Yeah, it is. This is the kind of thing, and I think this has ceased to be a discussion of the article we're talking about, and it's become a discussion of how to approach
Excuse me,
studying.
go ahead with the sources. I didn't want to hijack this. Go
No,
ahead.
no, no. I perfectly agree with that. Well, having finished actually talking about the sources, we'll just look at the headings for the article, because you really. I encourage people that are interested to read the article, because then you get the different points of view. Because we didn't try and write this as this is the only way of viewing it. We were very cautious. We had our opinions. I mean, there were three of us. We had three different opinions.
Yes.
But we were aware that some things were more likely than other things. That doesn't mean they're right. It just means they're more likely. Somebody, as I keep saying in our talks, somebody in Iran tomorrow could go out and go back to work on an archaeological excavation, or go back to work on going through a manuscript, and suddenly find the answer to one of these problems that we've been worrying about for years, because it was just sitting there, and it needs somebody with sharp eyes and a good mind to find it, whether it's a an arrowhead in the ground, or it's a description in a book. It's so easy to read through a book and skip over bits unconsciously, because you're following a pathway through it and you miss the bits on either side. And when we wrote this article, what it did was, it was you and Kaveh that were writing the article. You just invited some comments from me. And that's when I started to realize just how complicated it was.
Very
I don't
good.
think I could have even started off with this. I had a lot of these ideas, but I don't think I could have put them together without exchanging ideas with other people who knew as much or more than I did. I mean, I know little bits about little bits of armor and that through practical experience, and I usually have a good eye for sculpture and painting. Doesn't mean that I am even often right. I'm sometimes right. I wish I was more often right, but you just got to work real hard for that. So this is how the article's laid out. It
Thank
has
you.
an introduction. It divides things into period sources and archaeological finds of Sasanian armor. It splits armor, as we were discussing, into mail armor, scale and lamellar armor. Armor for protecting the arms and legs, which we were referring to as laminated armor earlier in the discussion. And we split that into hand and arm protection, because there are surviving Sasanian gauntlets.
Yes.
That's really, really rare. And they're
Yes.
quite interesting. They're very articulated. They're probably sewn onto a leather glove, metal pieces.
Yes.
And then also leg armor. Now, to be honest, I don't know whether any of this leg armor has survived. There's certainly bits of the arm armor have survived, and even in the Western Roman Empire, they have. But the leg armor is so clearly depicted on the sculptures,
Yes.
because in one case, I think Artaban's doing a somersault as he gets knocked out of his saddle by
Yes.
Dashius' lance, and his legs are way up, and you can see the armor running down his legs and everything like that. So it wasn't like greaves and thigh pieces. It was like trousers made out of strips of metal.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And
We went, sorry.
good. We are going just to add. We are going to add. You're going to describe two different types of armors, and we are going to put it at the end of this discussion today. I just wanted to mention that to our
Yeah, because
viewer.
what we're going to do is, we're going to I'm going to separately video some stuff, and we're going to put this as an addendum, because to pull it out and throw stuff around and talk sensibly at the same time is pretty hard, because you get too fascinated by the objects and you forget to follow the argument.
Yes,
Getting back to the sections of the article, the next one is helmets. There's a lot of interesting information about Sasanian helmets, and some, good historians of in the West, like James, see Sasanian helmets as influencing later Roman helmets. Not the early ones, but in the later empire, a type of helmet that sometimes is called a Spangen helm, but it's different from the standard Spangen helm, though there were that type was also known in Iran. So that's quite significant. Shields, we know there were lots of shields used because they're described by the people who were fighting the Sasanians, particularly the late Romans. And we have the illustration of a small cavalryman's shield in the statue of Khusra. We don't see any shields being used in the sculptures from the time of Ardashir and Shapur I, which doesn't mean they weren't using them. It means they weren't important for showing off how good the king was. There's the propaganda element in these things, and you know, that didn't go down well. The next one is horse armor. See, one of the things that we know the Sasanians had horse armor because the Romans and Greeks talked about it all the time. And we have this beautiful sculpture of Khusrau, and he's clearly got lamellar armor on the chest of his horse and the neck. And it's so clear that you can tell what type of scale it is. And as I said earlier, they've dug up scales like that in Iran. So it's of roughly the same period, actually. Horse armor from Dura Europos is often said to be Parthian or Sasanian, but it's very important to notice that the scales are standard Roman scales that are attached together by metal staples. I think there is no scales that I know of found in Iran that have these metal staples. The lamellar scales were laced, whether with leather or cloth laces, you know, that doesn't survive, but the sculptures clearly show the lacing. But that doesn't mean that the horse armors aren't representative of what horse armors used by the Sasanians were like. The horse armor on Khusrau's horse is for a more mobile form of heavy cavalry. So it doesn't cover the whole horse's body. It's mainly just the front part of the horse. So you're charging probably in close order, and it's not melee fighting, or it's not to defend against large bodies of horse archers or something like that. Because armor for horses is critical when you've got a lot of horse archers around, because the arrows that don't hit the man will hit the horse.
Yeah.
And in fact, there are sculptures from China, from the Tang Dynasty, from the second Tang Emperor's tomb, of his favorite horse. Well, his eight favorite horses are in the sculptures. But one of them's there, and one of his generals is extracting an arrow from its chest, and there are two arrows stuck in the cantle of its saddle. So it's dangerous to be a horse in battle, so horse armor is probably a very good idea. The other thing that we did at the end of the armor was a quick study of a bust from the Kermanshah Museum.
Yeah.
Izzad Bahram.
Yes.
Now, this is a really interesting sculpture because it's got a fairly detailed helmet, male avantail, male upper body, but there's something else there too, which seems to be strips of metal or leather, a laminated cuirass, or like a jawshan, which is what we thought to see it as.
To make it clear, the helmet, or what is he wearing, right? Hat cover, if a helmet, was already published some years ago, just to make this clear.
Oh, yeah. I think the actual whole sculpture was published it's in here. I'm not 100% sure, but it was only a small photograph, which made it difficult to... Because when we were doing the article, it was such a big thing that I found it hard to believe that it hadn't been published somewhere. This is this is a very big book. I think it's Gershman. We might have to dig that out. I think we mentioned it in the footnotes, actually.
Yes. I think this was also, I think it was in this pub. You know, some years ago, there was a, not a long time ago, in Poland, there was a gathering on Sassanid things. Was it not published as an article there?
Oh, in the, yeah. Yeah. Because I've got a copy of the thing from that. Yes, definitely it was in that. Sorry, I just stirred up a lot of dust then. Yeah, so it's been published in several different places. I'm not sure that people realize how interesting it was, because I don't think that, I think in the Polish one, there was in an article about hats and helmets.
Yes.
That they're mentioned of. And Iran, the Parthians and the Sasanians, in that, I think there was just a tiny photograph in one page. It didn't get the, I mean, there's been people that have been promoting it more because it's really an interesting sculpture. It was the top of a column, wasn't it?
I don't know exactly, to be honest.
I think I read that somewhere. But the thing that's interesting about it is it's relatively detailed.
Mm-hmm.
The really interesting bits have got bits of clothing draped over them, so we're not quite sure what they are. I'm really hoping they find another one that's a little bit more exposed. It's got strong cultural connections with Sasanian art. I think there's a corymbus on the top of the helmet, you know, like a little ball of hair, or it could be just a tuft. I think it's a very significant. I was going to say find, but it's not a find. If it's been known for a while, it's not a find. It's focusing on this, I think, is important. Having a look around to find out if there's more. Because if it was on top of a column, there might be a dozen of them. And, you know, Iran is full of archaeological sites.
Yeah.
And there's only so many archaeologists to go around. I mean, you know, anywhere else and you'd be saying, great, there's thousands of treasures of art and history to be discovered.
Yeah.
But the people working on it would probably like to have a little bit more help and a little bit more money so they could do what they do well.
Yeah.
But the thing about this, it's got lots of unique things. It's got a floral border to the male. So the male is scalloped, and at the where the scallops come together,
yeah,
there's like a little flower.
Yeah.
And this goes all the way around the bottom of the male. Things like this are very sophisticated. It suggests that male shirts, which we know were there at the beginning of the Sasanian dynasty, continued to evolve in an artistic sense, like they got extra bits put on them. It's like there's a gold-washed male shirt, I think belonging to a Polish or Transylvanian prince that's in one of the Polish collections that has gold ornaments attached to the male. To make it look like it was, you know, like a jacket made of embroidered fabric or something.
Mm-hmm.
So in Iran, at this early date, almost certainly what we're seeing in that sculpture is refinements in the decoration and presentation of the male. It may not have been any more effective, but it certainly would have been more impressive. And it shows that the skill of the armourers didn't just stop at making utilitarian equipment.
Yeah.
If you look at the sculptures, the Sasanian kings and their nobles, because there's a lot of sculptures with the king and vast groups of nobles, they had a passion for their swords. You always see big, impressive swords being held in prominent positions. They love their horses because there's often sculptures of really, you know, fine-looking horses. There's even silver writings for pouring drinks in the form of saddled horses with little chains so the rider doesn't fall off. Not, you know, like seat belts more than stirrups. So the 400 years of this dynasty, they kept refining and improving things. Some things, mail was still being used in the 19th century. It never completely disappeared. I mean, in Europe, it wasn't used very much, but it was still being used in India. And judging by European accounts of finding Indian soldiers, it was very disconcerting when a European cavalryman got his saber up and whacked somebody and the saber just slid off them because they had a mail shirt on underneath their regular clothes. And of course, Europeans had forgotten about mail. So it, even, you know, under those circumstances, it was a surprise and it was still a useful thing. One of the oldest types of armor still in use. Scale was still being used, but it was never at the level that mail was after the fall of the Assyrians and that. We actually went into some discussion about the origins of mail and how Iran got its mail. That is quite complicated, and I don't think it's something that, I mean, you could do an hour on that and still you wouldn't actually get to the bottom of it. But so that's it. There's a conclusion to the article, which we, you know, refer to how sophisticated armor was in Sasanian Iran, how it has its unique flavor. You would never mistake. I mean, the Romans, the Eastern Romans and the Sasanians fought for the whole length of the Sasanian Empire. There were, you know, the very first thing they did was fight each other. The second Sasanian, Shahanshah, captured a Roman emperor in battle and was very proud of it because he put sculptures of it everywhere. And they fought right to the end until the Arabs overwhelmed them.